I was wondering if you could describe what a transition to a greener economy would actually look like. And also, what would you have to say to Americans who live in coal, gas, and oil-dependent economies?
Well, what it would look like is a presidency where we have someone who has made a pledge to the American people that I will make you this pledge right now. If I am elected to this high honor, I will make defeating climate change the number one priority of the United States. And I believe I can accomplish that. And the reason is that now people are understanding the loss that people are suffering from this. It's interesting, I met a woman named Marsha Moss. I was at Seminole Springs. It was a community, beautiful little community of mobile homes that got devastated, over 100 homes. And after I was done touring it, this woman named Marsha Moss asked me to come to her house to show me what was left of everything she owned. And she showed me, my house is destroyed. I only have two things to sustain me right now. One is my driveway, because I built it. She had this beautiful little rock inlay she did, and I'm proud of that. But the other thing that sustains me is hope that we're going to build a clean energy future so that we reduce carbon dioxide, so that the Western United States is not consumed by these forest fires. And she was happy that I provided her that hope. That's what an administration looks like. 100% clean electricity, millions of new jobs, a just transition, and this. It is time to end the gravy train of giving $27 billion to the oil and gas industry of hard-earned taxpayer money. That money needs to go.
Governor, you just said 100% clean electricity, clean energy.
Yes.
So what happens to the approximately 1.2 million Americans right now still work in fossil fuel extraction and power generation?
Yeah, and I appreciated her question. And because I wanted to ask the second part of your question. It's a very important question. Look, one of the things we talk about in this is that we need a just transition. This is going to be a huge transition. We are a fossil fuel-based economy largely right now, and we know we're going to have to go to clean energy sources by the mid-century. Now, this is just a scientific fact. But while we do this, we have to make sure that people during that transition have opportunities along with everyone else. So we need to do the kind of things we've done in Centralia, Washington, where we are closing our last coal-fired plant to have about a $55 million fund to help those employees in training and transition assistance, to help businesses where we can make sure that local economy continues to thrive, and give it a transition period of several years so that there's not trauma for these families. This is very important. But we know we can do this, and I'll tell you why. We are a country of unparalleled innovative talent. I know that in my state. We've invented digital, economy, the first successful jet airplane, the artificial kidney machine. We even invented the $4 cup of coffee in Washington State. And we know that there are going to be jobs aplenty. It's interesting, there are 3 million people. You mentioned 1 million in fossil fuels. There's 3 million people tonight working in clean energy in the United States. It's growing twice as fast as the rest of the U.S. economy. The most rapidly growing job in America is solar installer. And second is wind turbine technician. This is a future that I believe it is our destiny to grasp. And when we do it, we're going to bring everybody along. That's the American way, and I'm pledging that tonight.
Governor, we got a question from Evan Brooks. He's studying environmental science as a member of the College Democrats at the University of Maryland.
Hello, Governor Inslee. One of the strengths of your campaign is the environment. Unfortunately, there has not been much information about your stances on several other issues. Mm-hmm. Recently, Nipsey Hussle, a well-respected community leader, activist, and artist who's attempting to do good in his community, was tragically gunned down. Mm-hmm. How will you attempt to fix the gun epidemic, and how will you improve gun violence in urban areas where gun violence is entrenched?
Well, this is something that is near to my heart that I've been fighting now for over a quarter of a century. I've known that it is time to confront the NRA and develop common sense gun legislation for a quarter of a century. And I'll give you an example of that because, sometimes politicians talk and don't back up with action. Have you noticed this? Well, in 1994, when I was a freshman legislator, I was representing Eastern Washington. It was a very Republican area, very agricultural area. And a lot of hunting folks, a lot of racks and pickups. But we needed just a few votes to pass the assault weapon bill. And I knew if I cast that vote, I was probably going to lose my seat in Congress, which is hard to do because I liked it at the time. And people said, look, you're going to lose your seat if you vote for this. I voted for that bill. I provided one of the critical votes to get it over the top. I lost my seat, but I have never regretted that vote because I do not believe any congressman's or politician's seat is more important than any child's life. And I fundamentally believe that.
So, Governor.
So we've done a lot more. We have passed three major gun safety legislations by initiative in our state, and we're not done yet. We are not going to back up against the NRA. We have them on the run. This country is moving forward to common sense gun legislation. I'm glad to be part of that.
All right, we got a question. Deanna Redder is a student focusing on psychology at Catholic University.
Given that Washington State has legalized marijuana, what is your view on legalizing marijuana across the country?
Thank you. And I missed your name. I'm sorry.
Deanna Redder.
Deanna, listen, I appreciate that because I'm happy to share Washington's experience, which is that we legalized marijuana several years ago. And the fears of a number, including myself, I actually did not support the initiative when it came up several years ago because I was concerned about youthful usage. But what we have found is that those fears have not come to pass. And I'm happy to share that with the rest of the world. We have not had adverse health results with our young people. We have not had rampant criminality in the distribution of marijuana. And it has been helpful by providing about $700 million of revenue so that we can help the health of our children and schools for our children. So it has been an unalloyed success in the state of Washington. And it is my belief it is time for the United States to decriminalize and legalize marijuana. I believe that very, very firmly. Now, this is just part of our effort to right some of the injustice in our judicial system, too, because the drug war has been one of the elements of such racial disparities in our judicial system. And we need to bring justice back into the justice system. That's one of the reasons I was the first governor to offer pardons to over 3,000 people with marijuana convictions, because the drug war has resulted in too much racial disparity. So I hope we get the whole country to follow Washington's lead. By the way, I think that sounds like a theme. Follow Washington's lead. Look west for success. I kind of like that.
Governor, you mentioned the crime bill. When you were a U.S. congressman, you voted in 1994 for the 1994 crime bill, which included stiffer penalties for drug crimes, contributing to the mass incarceration of a lot of people of color, as you know. Do you now regret that vote? And if elected, what would you do to make up for it?
Well, listen, that was a situation where many Democrats, including myself, believed that we needed some response to the epidemic of crime at the time. But I will tell you that this, if I knew then what I know now, I would not have cast that vote because it has resulted in racial disparities in our system. So since then, I have been very dedicated in helping to right the disparities that exist. And they didn't happen just because of that bill. They've been very deeply ingrained in our society. I'll just give you an example of the things I've done. We know that the drug war has been one of the reasons for racial disparities. We know that having panels of just white folks when you got a black defendant on a criminal trial is not a healthy thing. So we've changed our rules to try to get more diverse jury panels. We have adopted what I think could be the template of a law to try to reduce police violence so we don't get so much police violence, particularly against people in the communities of color. And we are training people, police officers, in de-escalation tactics so they do not get involved in violence against communities of color. All of these things are very important. Now, we're doing a bunch of other more long-term efforts as well, which
we've
been talking
about. Let me ask you, as president, you would have the pardon power, to pardon individuals. How far would you take that pardon power on this specific issue?
Well, I'd be very pressed to take it to Donald Trump. I'll tell you that. That would be very challenging. On this issue, I have used the pardon power to try to right wrongs probably more aggressively than certainly my predecessors, where we have found untoward sentences. And I've also been working to reduce the time period of sentences. I will tell you, in my state, I think we have people for property crimes that are serving too long in jail when they could be having rehabilitation and training so that they don't have recidivism. And I've been frustrated because I've not been able to get my legislature to join me yet. But this is an ongoing effort, and I look forward to future success.